to be the greatest heavyweight ever, break Rock and Roll Town's record of 49-0, break the record, probably go undefeated his whole career, become the greatest fighter ever because of custom model. He's sitting in Indianapolis, in Plainfield, Indiana, in the youth center, serving a 6-year sentence. Now you go figure it.
I didn't do this to take your career away. I did it because you need help, and if your so-called friends weren't big enough to tell you, at least I was. You hurt me, and I was big enough to stand up to you and tell you you need help. You hurt me, and I'm trying to help you.
I was young, you know what I mean? I wanted to have fun, I enjoyed having fun. And maybe I took it further, whatever. People know who I am, and people know I have money, and people know I'm young. You know what I mean? So they put the two together, young, black, single, with money. 90%, 80% of the people believe what they read. And, I mean, that has a big effect on people. If they ever got a chance to know me, they would think differently. They would think totally differently.
Continue like it is for a few weeks, and then we'll see what happens. This is what impressed me. this kid changed. I mean, this he because he wanted it. The teachers called from school. I knew one of the English teachers calls him. What the hell happened to this guy? And he went from like a few week period. He like won a year in his grade in reading level. He was trying. Mike and I were sparring one time. He hit me with a jab. It almost knocked me down. Luckily, I had the next week off from trying because my nose was broke and my eyes were all black. And I told my wife the next day, I said, that's it. I told him that I knew Customato, and I said, he'd take in kids like you and work with them. Floyd Patterson, Jose Torres, and he's had champions and worked with other champions. And he said, really? And he saw us as a way to make it. So we took him down to Catskill, and we talked all the way down. He says, what's it going to be like? I said, it's the top of a police station, simple as that. We're going to work out in the gym, just like you do up here. You'll be all right. You'll be all right. Don't worry about it. So we walked in. Teddy Atlas was the trainer.
Very good.
We wanted to see the spirit of Mike. He's coming towards us as a, you know, prospect. He was 12 years old. He was 190 pounds. We had nobody near that weight, so Bobby boxed him. He tried to be ferocious. He went after Bobby. He was very strong, and Bobby had to open up to keep him in his place from overwhelming him. And Bobby said, every time he hit me, he hurt me.
He was perfect. He was aggressive as hell. But we got ready, and we left 20 minutes later, and I said in the back porch, we got outside the back of the police station. I said, guess what he said about you, punk? He says, you continue down the line you're on now and become the heavyweight champion of the world. And he hugged me, and he says, he did not. He did, I'm telling you.
Wanted to be involved with this kid.
First time I drove him down myself. And he drove in this long driveway. He's looking. He said, what's this? I said, this is the house. Custom house? He said, I'm going to stay here? What am I going to do? Take the garbage out? I said, probably. He said, there's a lot of other things you're going to do too. But I said, if you behave and you do what you're supposed to, you will live here with me on Cust.
Big house with like 13 or 14 rooms. And Mike and other young fighters all stayed there. Many of them never even turned professional. It was just like a halfway house for juvenile delinquents. And the Cuss had a room on the top floor that no one was ever allowed to enter.
That's why I never want anybody to come in my room. When I want to find something, I want to be able to find it.
I met Cuss in 1939. He was like a cuckoo bird. He had a terrible thing about gangsters. If he went to a restaurant, he'd have to seat himself looking over here, looking here, seated by the door, or look under the bed when he went home, or open the closet.
He was half mad and half blind and all trainer, had a head full of incredible knowledge, and had this impact on every fighter that he had ever trained. He saw it with Jose Torres, who later became the light heavyweight champion, Floyd Patterson, who became the heavyweight champion. It was almost as though he had a branding on him, and he would stamp Customato's thought patterns or whatever on the fighter.
Your mind is not in your work. Your mind is not in your work. There's something distracting you.
But they gotta have the initial interest. They gotta have the spark there for me to fan. If there's no spark, I can't put life. I'm not a creator. What I do is discover and uncover. See? And when I uncover, the boys themselves discover qualities in themselves that didn't even know they had.
Well, he had a room of his own. He slept with Frankie because he slept in the third floor, because mostly boys slept in the third floor. Television, a radio, plenty to eat, to him was like heaven.
It was good, right? Boom. Mm-hmm.
He was fun. And he's easy to fool, too. He's easy to goof on and fool. And so it made it look cute, you know, like some big guy, you're fooling them and stuff. And he was a lovable guy in ways. He was, you know, he was hugging people and stuff. And he needed that, too.
He comes out of a boy's home. He comes to Catskill. There are people who are friendly. There's no one saying, okay, I just fed you, now you're going to do this for me. You know, you say, hey, Lenny, could you take me to the store and get me a milkshake? You know, buy him a milkshake. And a couple days later, he tries to pay you back. And you say, Michael, that's okay. You don't have to pay me back. It's no, I did this because I'm your friend. I'm not doing this for you.
He was very sensitive about people picking on him in school. I know some kids would call him names. They call him Mighty Joe Young because kids could be mean, and they would use that name to make fun of the size of him. And a change happened in Mike. Through boxing, he obviously became more proud of himself and sure of himself.
That took the body right hand to the jaw. Bend down. That took the body right hand to the jaw. I know there was a guy, a middleweight contender, good fighter, good puncher. Good fighter. His name was Dave.
His name was, that his name?
Shane. Huh? Dave was
Shane.
Yeah, that's right. Dave Shane. That's right. I don't know him.
And he fought Mickey Walker.
Fought everybody. Yeah, he knocked him the first guy, knocked out, what's his name? He became a lightweight champion of the world. He bought out Buffalo.
Slattery?
Slattery. This guy remembers everybody. Slattery.
I look at these guys, when I first came here, I thought they was, you know, God. I thought they was born like that, but they're not, you know. They're just ordinary people. I would like to be something like them. Not much flamboyant or something, arrogant, you could say, but just different from all the fighters nowadays. Because that's somewhere I just like being. I like being sometimes a little arrogant. A little bit, not much, just a little bit. And, you know, a little spoiled. I like that. That's me, and it's always going to be me. And I'm not going to try to change it for nobody.
Mike was cocky and shy at the same time. He was a little boy once you got to know him, but it took a bit of going through the layers to find this out. You know, he sometimes swaggered. He was a bad kid in his head.
The first time I saw Mike Cuss was in September of 1980 when Jose Torres drove me up to Catskill, New York. It was an astounding experience. He was obviously a prodigy. It was like the first time I saw John Coltrane, or the first time I saw Bruce Springsteen, or the first time I read Norman Mailer, or the first time I saw Baryshnikov. It was clear this was somebody special.
Figured out how to make it work. I said, what do you mean? He says, well, in the dance, he said, I'm always afraid they're going to say no if I ask them to dance. He said, now I know what to do. He said, you run up and you grab their hand and you take them out on the floor quick before they have a chance to say no. He said, and then they won't say no because they're too embarrassed, so they'll wait till the dance is over.
Yeah, he was my first love. I didn't like him at first. I remember I used to come home from school and I used to see him and I knew he liked me, right? So one day I can remember, he was coming home and he said, are you scared of me? And I was one of those girls, like, my mother would say, don't show a man you're afraid of him. So I was like, no, I'm not afraid of you. And he went, boo, and I ran up the street and he laughed, you know, he was cracking up.
He just knows how to fight. He's very quick for a heavyweight. Tyson.
Very, very strong boxer, Tyson.
I tell you.
Very, very strong.
Brown has taken some vicious punishment and held on. He's
really
still in
has.
There.
I don't think he's...
There's another right by Tyson.
He's just
left right.
He's giving up. Patel's coming in. Look at old Tyson jump on the rope.
That is it. They threw the towel in.
Threw the towel in. He didn't want to see his boxer hurt.
I think the towel hit the canvas about 35 seconds into the fight.
Look at old Tyson. He's falling on the ground with joy. Six bouts, six knocks.
Come here.
Necessary to protect my people and people that were close to me.
Mike Tyson bolted from that gym and ran down Main Street in Catskill, ran all the way home, and that was the final break. Mike Tyson was sent back up to the Tryon School by Custom Auto, the reform school he had come out of, for a few days until things cooled off. And during that time, Custom Auto got rid of Teddy Atlas.
Put in all the effort and all the time and all the misery and heartbreak.
he got around and enjoyed it.
Cuss taught him what Cuss called elusive aggression, which I think was the signature of Cuss's method. It became known as the peekaboo style because of the hand held high, but I think the cornerstone of what Cuss taught was head movement, to move your head after you punched every time. He had timing and leverage and strength and a desire to put his through the back of your head.
The first time I saw him, he got up in the ring, and I think the first or second round, he knocked this guy. I thought he had knocked his head off because I'd never seen anybody hit somebody like that. And the amazing thing I remember is, like, he wasn't satisfied. You could almost feel like he wanted the guy to get up so he could knock him out again.
You get hit with jabs, wild hooks, pulverizing right-hand leads, and he keeps coming and coming.
Went up into the mirror, and he was holding it up like this and just staring in the mirror, and truly
I remember this girl walking up to him, like, Mike Tyson, Mike Tyson. And he was, like, shocked. Wow, they know me. And I'm like, Mike, people know you.
Oh, my goodness. I saw you on TV the other night.
Please welcome Mike Tyson.
I seen a guy that throws elbows, I seen a guy that throws butts, I seen a guy that hits after the bell,
I seen all of this in Mike Tyson. I didn't see a gentleman in there. If they want to make him out of a beast that he's claimed to be, he's going to be in there with a beast.
Ladies and gentlemen, the man known as the Eastern Assassin, former heavyweight champion of the world, Larry Holmes!
The last friendly, warm and friendly meeting I had with Mike was after the Holmes fight. For the Holmes fight, Mike was going with three girls, which seemed to be semi-serious about three women. This was Miss America, Robin, and a very gorgeous model. We put one in one section, one in the second section, one in the third section, completely separated. And he sat here and we talked about it and we laughed about it. And so when he left, I started to say, where are you going now, Mike? He said, I'm going to the coast. Those were the last things he said to me prior to his being married to Robin.
Robin, inquiring minds want to know, how does a woman who went to Sarah Lawrence and Harvard Medical School wind up falling in love with a guy who's a graduate of the School of Hard Knocks?
God, I want to know, too. There's something, we have a lot in common, traditional families, and we just sort of love each other. We sort of love at first sight. It was hard in the beginning, but we got through it, and we ended up married.
Well, just 3 weeks after the marriage, I got a call from Robin. I am Mrs. Mike Tyson, and I'm taking over. I demand this, and I demand this. I said, wait a minute.
We welcome you back to Live at Five,
thank
Robin.
You.
The Sports Illustrated article and some of the others, the tone is that suggests that you and your mother are opportunists and that you are meddling too much in Mike's career.
Right. That's absurd. First of all, I'm Michael's wife. And not only that, but we're family. I mean, my mother has become Michael's mother. An incident happened and we noticed a discrepancy with Michael's money. That's what sort of opened up everything. If Michael has $50 million and he's supposed to have $70 million, there's a problem.
In a way, Robin and Ruth were like a football team. The mother-in-law had a game plan. The game plan was to get Mike Tyson on the field, march the ball up the field, score the touchdown. End of game, they march away with the ball and the money and fame and fortune and all that.
Don King looked on Mike Tyson's marriage as his opportunity, giving him advice and counsel on how to take Mike over, how to make problems of various kinds for me.
But the women, being shrewd and greedy, criminal smartness, they said to themselves, screw Don King, we don't need him. We don't need him. You know, we're going to have him, he's going to take our money. We don't need him. We're going to take all the money we can get now.
From Cincinnati, Ohio, he is the second-ranked heavyweight in the world and a former heavyweight champion. Ladies and gentlemen, the challenger, Tony TNT Cole.
My mission is to go and destroy and not to let anything get involved. You get punched, you get hurt. I refuse to be hurt, knocked down, and knocked out. I can't lose. I refuse to lose.
You saw behind Mike's shoulder there his co-manager, Bill Caton. For the first time since Mike's been fighting as a professional, the other co-manager, Jim Jacobs, has not been able to make this trip.
Funeral services were held at Hillside Memorial Cemetery for boxing manager Jimmy Jacobs, who died Wednesday. Heavyweight champion Mike Tyson, Jimmy Jacobs.
Well, Mike was at Jimmy Jacobs' funeral. There were shouting matches with people from Merrill Lynch over trust funds that Mike had put away. The mother and Robin Givens herself were up at offices of an investment firm trying, screaming desperately to get the money. You have poor Cush and poor Jimmy gone, rest his soul. All these forces struggling for the soul of Mike Tyson. Now we have Don King at the gate. This is a man who does not discourage easily.
And I try to tell Jim and Bill, King said to me, he was going to take your fight. I'm trying to tell you, he won't take it. Jim Jacobs and Bill King, oh, no, they're too, blah, 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 blah. Hey, where did he end up? I tried to tell you, but, hey, that's business.
Now he's getting ready to fight Michael Spinks. The fight is in Atlantic City. They managed to get through the training period during the week, but on the weekends, Ruth Roper and Robin Givens would come down to Atlantic City to lend their particular brand of charm to this already inflammatory situation. And Trump was romancing them.
I happen to know Robin Givens Tyson. She is one hell of a fine lady.
And Caton was trying to be there and trying to prove to the world that Mike Tyson loved him, which he didn't. And it was just a constant emotional drain on everybody. And so I come down here. And he says, we could talk. So to break the ice, I said, where do you run in the mornings? You don't have to be a rocket scientist to start an interview. And he said to me, I went on a boardwalk. And I said, great. I said, what do you think about it? He said, I think about Gus. And some of the things he told me. And how right he was about some things. And how he's not here anymore to help me. And then I begin to think about different things. And he said, it occurs to me how much more fun it used to be. I mean, it wasn't about money then so much. We were all like a family. We were together. But then suddenly everything, he said, they died, and meaning Gus and Jimmy, he said, and everything became money, money, money. And he said, now it's like I don't have anybody to talk to. Now, this is a newlywed saying this. And he leans forward, and he grabs me against my chest. And he is literally going through absolute total hysteria, and the water is flowing. So much to the point that when the interview was over, I had to go back upstairs and change my shirt.
Special edition, Atlantic City Express, souvenir, get in there, get it hot. News and more, 35 cents.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, once and for all, let's get ready to rumble 12 rounds for the undisputed heavyweight championship of the world.
You sure my prediction?
Yeah.
I think a black guy's gonna win.
Yeah.
Picking Michael Spinks in the 10th round.
I definitely picked the guy with the short pants.
Spinks and Tyson, it's on. The world is waiting for this fight. So you go to each other's dressing room to check the wraps and the gloves and so forth. I walk down. You know, I always try to get an edge where I can when my guy's getting ready. But I go in and I think I'm going to rattle the kid because he's under a lot of pressure. At the time, Jacobs had passed. Jim Jacobs, the closest guy to him, had died right on the verge of this happening. He was in the mix with Robin Givens. Don King is trying to pull him away from Caton. So I'm in the dressing room with Tyson, and I'm looking to rattle this guy. I walk in, and he's punching. Standing there, he and Rooney's putting something on, he's punching holes in the wall. I'm like, to myself, oh, no. This guy's getting ready to fight my guy, my little guy. And he's punching holes in the wall before he goes out to fight? Oh, no. That night, Mike Tyson knew that his whole life had built to this moment. He had been groomed like a gladiator. He was so tuned to that fight because he felt that unless he performed in that ring, then nobody would accept him outside of the ring. That Tyson that we met that night, no other boxer professionally or as an amateur has seen that Mike Tyson other than Mike. Mike Tyson was at the best he could be that night.
Now watch Tyson jump right into his chest.
When Tyson fought Spinks, Tyson's purse was somewhere in the neighborhood of $22 million. The fight, of course, only lasted barely a minute and a half, 91 seconds. You divide that up and you see Mike Tyson earned almost $250,000 a second for that fight. And Spinks didn't do too badly either. He earned about $150,000 a second because he made about $13 million in the fight.
Tyson not afraid, as we expected, and Spinks ready to mix it up with him. Tyson along the ropes doing damage.
Michael Spinks has keep moving because every shot.
Oh, uppercut landed inside and Spinks went down. It was the left uppercut.
I was surprised there was a body shot that put him to the canvas.
And that is the first time Michael Spinks has ever been down in a professional fight.
And he's down again and in serious trouble. A right hand right on the chin.
Slip a diamond under your pillow or
you know, you say, bring me something back, and you mean, like, I mean, anything, and comes back with a Porsche. I mean, things like that. It's just Michael.
From the standpoint of Mike Tyson, she was like a fairy princess, actually. And what happened after the marriage, Mike became thoroughly and completely obsessed with her. It's an obsession that I have never seen in any man before to a woman.
Very much in love. You were so in love with her that just sometimes you could see her, his face was the pain there.
After the Sphinx fight, there was the stormy summer of 88 in hand against Mitch Green. The affairs in Moscow at the hotels with ranting in the lobbies. The crack-up of the car in Catskill. All because Robin is driving Mike crazy.
Michael is a manic depressive. He is. I mean, that's just a fact. It's been torture. It's been pure hell. It's been worse than anything I could possibly imagine. I think for the first time I can understand abused women. There's a time when he cannot control his temper, and that's frightening to me, or to my mother. I don't know what Mike Tyson would be without my mother, what we would be. I mean, she's been the glue that's kept us together.
If I was Mike, I would just give her something. I don't know. I would give this, stuck my hands in her mouth or what.
Gibbons called police to the Bernardsville house this weekend, claiming the tramp was tearing up the house and threatening her and her mother.
If she wants to right now, take me. She can leave right now. Take everything I have and leave.
Love can be fleeting. The soap opera marriage of boxing champ Mike Tyson and actress Robin Gibbons is coming to an end. She announced today through her lawyer that she's seeking a divorce after 8 months together.
Robin Gibbons was the jab that set Mike up for the Don King right hand. I mean, by the fall of 1988, Mike's life is in shambles, and Don King moved in.
Don King is my man. He's the best at what he does.
So suddenly there's a whole new cast of characters around Mike. And I think that Kevin Rooney didn't fit into the picture. He got involved in the fighter's personal life. Tyson didn't like that. He probably also had Don King whispering in his ear about maybe he'd be better off with new people around him. And he fired Kevin Rooney.
My philosophy was like, people basically suck. Because really, I mean, they're always trying to screw you.
Everyone?
These different occasions where you run into nice people, you know what I mean? But, you know, you've been through experience, you know. They don't have no emotion towards human feelings, you know?
Hard to trust.
Absolutely.
Mike Tyson is the most famous athlete in the world. Fame has even followed Tyson across the sea to Japan.
Tyson's in Japan to defend his heavyweight boxing title against James Buster Douglas. But win or lose that match, Tyson will leave Tokyo millions of dollars richer.
They assemble a corner for that fight, which looks like it was picked up out of the semifinals of the Inner City Golden Gloves. Tyson felt he had nothing to be concerned about with Douglas. He obviously did not train. He had a lot of problems as far as paying attention to business. This is a kid who virtually lived in the gym in the Catskills. Now, I don't want to train today. Well, you know, who's going to tell him?
You know, I started hearing him start saying different things. I'm the baddest man on this planet. No one can beat me on this planet. You never know what's going to happen. It's great to have confidence in yourself, but don't get overconfident.
Please welcome the challenger, James Buster Douglas.
As a fighter, Mike Tyson was much more than a bully. He was a fighter, but he had reached the stage in Tokyo where all that was left was the bravado and the aura of a bully.
Mike said, all right, now I'm a man. Now I'm on my own. He's taking the macho thing. I can handle it. And if I let my guard down, I go to somebody and say, hey, I need help. I can't handle this. I know how to fight. I don't know how to handle all this other stuff that goes with it. But then who does he go to say that he can trust that person? He doesn't know. So he has to kind of wing it. Then he starts to kind of get out of sync because it's not the guy there that says, back on track, Mike. Back on track. Mike, stop. That's no good. You shouldn't do that. That's the wrong thing to do. You should be doing this. You should be doing that. That was gone out of his life. And this kid had to start to bend, start to try to trust people he didn't know, deal with things he didn't ever have to deal with before. And he's just a kid. He shouldn't have to. He's a boxer.
Introducing the undefeated.
champion again within 6 months.
Buster Douglas is still beating Mike Tyson. Mm-hmm. You know, that's like a Volkswagen knocking off a Mercedes, if you know what I mean, in a race. Mm-hmm. You just don't think things like that.
I know, but you know, he's, like I said before, you know, I abused myself, abused my body. And, like, when you reach a status at, you know, a young age, you know, I mean, like, being 20, 19, even though I wasn't a champion at 19, you know, I mean, I was proclaimed, you know, I was wealthy, and I was, and it was a little too much, you know, I don't want to, you know, use excuses, you know, and being 20 years old, being champion, well, you're really too young.
Long before Mike was in any trouble, a guy named Tim Layden, who was not a sports reporter, but a police beat reporter up at the Albany Times Union, and he said to me, quote, "Mike's biggest problem, far and away, is women. That's the problem that's going to wind up nailing him someday." Joe Mahoney, another reporter, just said, "Absolutely, women are Mike Tyson's, quote, Achilles heel." So, I mean, this is 4 years before the Desiree Washington thing.
I mean, you got 200 girls that are trying to give you a phone number a day. Not 15, 20, 200. When I worked for him in a China Club, the biggest thing was actually keeping the girls away. I was like, white girls, Spanish girls, Chinese, you know, Asian. They're all over him. All over him.
When we had him in our offices for a conference with Don King, we're on the seventh floor of a building that's 28 stories high. A state office building. Everybody in this building knew he was here. They came down from upstairs. They came up from downstairs. By the hundreds, they came off the street to see Mike Tyson, who was sitting on the floor. And I was standing there watching as he sat on the floor signing autographs, many times running his hand right up the leg of a woman he never met in his life. Some of them loved it and let him get away with it. Some of them pulled back. One of them even cracked him on the top of the head, took the autograph and ripped it up.
The world has this impression of us as here's a guy who goes around grabbing people and stuff like that, and that's not true. First of all, for me to grab you, you have to be within my reach. So that says a lot. I can't grab you from across the street. I can't grab you from the distance. You know, your arm is only so many inches long.
First time I met him was quite a distressing circumstance. I was at Gleason's gym. He was talking with a group of people, and I came over and said that I'm a reporter with El Diario La Prensa. Could you spare a few minutes? He made some very odd sexual references in Spanish and started doing this odd sort of salsa in front of me, like sticking his arms out and waving them. And I knew those words were from the gutter. You know, you don't have to know Spanish to know what the meaning was. And at that point, he reached out and he grabbed my breast. And I was shocked. I was stunned. I didn't know what to do. So I hit him.
Anytime you bring Mike Tyson up, people would talk about the past, or Robin Givens, or I'm beating women, or grabbing women. Who is he to grab girls' butts? Girls want their butts grabbed, all right? People like excitement. Mike Tyson was excitement.
When I found out that he was staying at the hotel, and before the fight, I called him up, and I said something, like, really stupid. I called him. I was like, "Hi, Mike. You know, I think you're great. You're awesome. You know, you're my fantasy, you know, you have a perfect body, you're great."
He sees a woman coming at him, maybe after he's been drinking, he's been celebrating, she's happy, she grabs him and hugs him and says, "Oh, you're great, and you're my hero, and I'm so happy to be near you." She may just mean that. Not all women who throw themselves at athletes in the interest of developing a friendship want to be sexual with.
If you meet him at a club and say, "Hey, baby, you know, you look great, I want to be with you," I don't think Mike thinks you want to, you know, have a picnic at Central Park and play Monopoly.
When a woman is handing you her underwear to give to my boss, I kind of gather what she wants to do. They don't want to talk about boxing, that's for sure. So we basically knew what they wanted and how fast and how long they had. You know, some of the stuff went on in airplanes in between cities. You know, there's always a bathroom on an airplane. And, you know, you had a few that we had to get rid of, that I had to get rid of with money, because it's very hard at 3 o'clock in the morning in Los Angeles in a limousine when a girl just finished having sex with him for 2 hours. Now she doesn't want to get out of the car, and she's telling me that, well, she's not going anywhere. So now if I put my hands on her, it becomes a police matter.
There was a point, you know, when behind closed doors, he did get rough, and it was clear that's what he liked. I don't think he thought he was being rough. I just thought that's the kind of sex he likes. So, you know, I don't know, it was a man thing where if I give it to you, you're going to like it.
I was looking at something, but I heard him close the door. And I turned around, you know, I heard this lock, you know, I'm like, this doesn't sound good. And as soon as I turned around, I mean, he just came at me. It was horrible. At one point, I was on my stomach, and he had my hand back like this. And he had a hand over my mouth, so I couldn't, I was trying to scream. I was moving so much that I screamed. And one of the women that works for him happened to be up on that floor, and she came and she knocked, you know, wondering, you know, something was wrong.
What happens between two people in a bedroom becomes something that you never know. There are some women that enjoy rough sex. There are some women that like passion. So there's all kind of things. So it's not what you do, it's who you do it with.
Desiree was a really good cheerleader. She was everyone's friend on the squad. And a lot of the girls were afraid to speak up to our coach, because our coach always seemed like she had to put it in place. And we would never bring up what we thought we should do or what we felt. And Desiree was never afraid to go up to her and approach her and tell her how we felt and how she felt. And I think she was almost one of the only girls on the squad that would do that. She would always go up to Miss Bowden and just tell how she felt. And she wasn't afraid of the consequences either. She always told us how happy she was to be in the pageant and that she wanted to win. She was so eager to win. And she had mentioned, like, once or twice that she couldn't wait to go to the Miss Black America pageant. She was all excited about that.
Contestant 8, Desiree Washington from Coventry, Rhode Island.
What's it like growing up here?
Boring. There's not much to do. It's not a big town. There's no, like, big movie theaters. There's no clubs or anything to go to.
You know, wherever we go, we never have to lock a door. You know, when we leave our house, we never have to lock the doors. You know, everyone knows everyone. If there's a stranger, you know, everyone knows it, you know. If there's someone new at the high school or something, everyone would know, you know.
Like a big family.
There's a new student, you know. Yeah, this is kind of like a big family.
Supported by Don King for many years. Mike Tyson has never went there. Mike Tyson went there to enjoy himself with Angie B, to hang out with the festivities that he never done before. It was relaxation. Just came off of a tough fight.
Wants to be able to do what he wants without being scrutinized. Wants to go out and do all the normal things normal young red-blooded people do.
If you bringing a hawk in a chicken yard. And wonder why the chicken got eaten up. You bring Mike to a beauty contest.
Yeah.
And all these fine boxes just parading in front of Mike. Mike's eyes begin to dance like a hungry man looking at a Wendy's beef burger or something.
Women such an array. What can I say? Yeah, definitely. That sounds better.
And he wanted to see if this is as good as it looked. Mike wanted him to show me, you know.
For the first time in 3.5 years. Mike is on his own. And I found it at that time to be weird, and I also remember being scared that if something happens and we're not with him, we were contracted to be with him. We're not contracted to be away from him.
But he's left a trail of stories about his behavior in his wake. It began with these words on WTLC radio last week. Tyson said, quote, "The people here, the most beautiful women. You know, I'm a woman's man. God, I'm in trouble now."
Never-ending rehearsals. One girl said that they were lucky if they got a meal in the morning. And of course, they came there expecting to be shuttled from breakfast, lunch, and dinner, catered affairs, and meeting dignitaries. And here they were, just working all day and all night long. But as soon as Mike Tyson walked in, suddenly there were no more sore feet or aching backs. The girls all sprang to life, and there were these oohs and ahs and squeals of, oh, Mike Tyson's here.
Later the same day, sources at the beauty pageant photo shoot tell us that Tyson met with the women competing in the Miss Black America competition. Sources say that Tyson and many of the contestants exchanged
phone numbers. Desiree, I think, came into this, new to this whole experience. She had won the Miss Rhode Island Black America pageant, and I was a little wide-eyed from everything I've been told.
Hello, my name is Desiree. My ideal mate is athletic, and baseball is what he likes to play. He'll argue his case for specific times and dates, because I love a man who loves to debate. He'll reach for the highest star, no matter how far, and his love for me will be so great. This is my ideal mate. Thank you.
She was 18 years old, just graduated from high school, looking forward to going to college, hoping to go to Brown University. Quite bright. And I had visited the Soviet Union this summer before as part of a leadership scholarship that she'd won, the Hugh O'Brien Scholarship. So I guess the world was sort of just opening up to Desiree, and she thought that her future was in front of her.
I also plan to study politics and be the first woman and black president of the United States of America.
I can tell you that there has been a rape incident report made, and it's my understanding that Mr. Mike Tyson has been alleged to have committed the crime.
The official police report, although purposefully vague, clearly shows the alleged rape victim claims that she was, quote, forced to submit to vaginal intercourse. Police are asking questions about Tyson's stay.
Anything said on Mike the
I mean it. How you doing, Mr. Charlie?
All right.
See you. I come to a
port here in Indianapolis. What do you want people to know here?
You know, basically, I'm innocent. Didn't do nothing to her. They're going to be watching. This will happen. I know it happened, and we're going to prove that I'm innocent.
Tyson went down there. He got jammed up a little bit. This girl claims that he raped her. So King said, well, now, let me get a lawyer that I think that I can trust. So he gets Vince Fuller. Vince Fuller doesn't know anything about rape. Anything.
Within the past hour, the jury has returned four indictments, one for rape, two charges of criminal deviant conduct, and one charge of confinement.
Tyson says his fame makes him an easy target. He maintains he's innocent.
I didn't hurt anyone or do anything to anyone. I mean, I love women. You know what I mean? My mother's a woman. I respect them as well.
Tyson's boxing promoter, Don King, stepped in several times during questioning, raising the issue of what he calls frivolous lawsuits filed against the boxer.
This woman had no personality to us. She had no name, no identity. We didn't know who she was. And Mike Tyson had everything to us. I mean, I'm a longtime Tyson fan, and not even necessarily a boxing fan. I like what I think Tyson represents to me in terms of where he came from. I grew up in the South Bronx. He grew up in Brownsville, so I definitely identify with his level, his ability to get out of where he was, and basically just run it, you know? I mean, Mike was the man.
What do you find a lot?
lot of the public say to you when you're out in the public right now here in Las Vegas, when you're around town, with all the talk, all the stuff that has happened in the past recently? Do you get a lot of support from people? Do you get jeered by people?
I hate people say, I love you. You know, we're all with you and we support you.
Greg Garrison was a special prosecutor brought in specially to handle this case. And boy, Greg Garrison was brilliant. He started from the moment the prospective jurors came in, and he'd say to them, you know, Sam, you go into, let's say you go into a dark alley some night, you're wearing a Rolex watch, you shouldn't be watched. Some guy jumps out at you and takes your Rolex watch. You're there on the sidewalk bleeding. Are you willing to say that you haven't been a victim of a crime? No. Without fail, everyone says no. Well, what about the fact that you were there in the middle of the night in a place in a bad neighborhood, a place you knew was a bad neighborhood, wearing a Rolex watch? Does that make it any less of a crime? Is he any less guilty? No, no. You know, down the line, the heads were shaking. Sometimes people he wasn't even talking to were shaking their heads saying, no, absolutely not. Greg Garrison was effectively saying, you're going to hear about a girl who was in exactly the same position. And yes, she may have exercised bad judgment, but no means no.
No means no. No means no. No means no.
Shame on you people. Shame on you for blaming the victim.
Oh, is she a victim? He's a victimizer. You just
it's
a victim.
It's
he's
the
being
truth.
Raped, right?
To rape a lot of people, truth to come out a certain way. In the William Kennedy Hill Thomas confrontation, lots of men and women were rooting for the good for feminism. It would be good for rape victims. And on the other side, there were some people who were rooting for it to come out the other way. I don't think you can root for the outcome of the case. We have to know the facts.
After the whole Thomas Hill thing, a writer wrote an editorial in the New York Times, well, op-ed piece, basically saying that black men and black women had different kinds of sexual styles with each other. So that, in that case, the harassment was cultural. And for Anita Hill to be offended with it meant that she was acting out of culture. And believe it or not, there are rape cases like that where defendants will come in and say, well, you have to understand that in the black community, we're very different about these things, you know.
Vincent Fuller came in with the idea, I believe, that he was going to sell conservative Indiana jurors on the fact that Mike Tyson was, just as you've always imagined, the stereotypical black athlete. Not only that, he was a fighter. He's a brutal guy by nature, by design, by habit, by profession. And he's accustomed to talking to people, particularly women, in a certain way. And it's very crude, it's very gruff. You know how those black people talk, was essentially what Fuller was saying to the jury. You know, they talk in terms of, you know, making love and sex all the time and rap music. It just encourages it. They all listen to it. He even asked Desiree Washington on the stand whether she listened to rap music and who her favorite artists were. I mean, he really pounded the table on that one, that she, in fact, knew all about it. She knew what Tyson was up to, and she was game.
You could trust her with anything. She was very honest to everyone. She never lied about things. She'd listen to you if you had problems, and she'd try to help you. She never bad-mouthed anyone. She always minded her own business.
They wanted us to believe that she was a gold digger, that this 18-year-old girl who said she wanted to be president of the United States was really looking for a big payday.
She must have heard the story about her. She couldn't be that naive that she hasn't heard about it.
Like you said, probably her personality was like, she's so confident that no one will rape me. No one has
stop Mike Tyson. Now, I know I'm a big woman. I could hardly stop him if he wanted something. I would have to think about it. There's no way of stopping him. My saying no would not stop him. I could not restrain him in any way. I could not get away from him.
How could she be out 1 a.m? Who did she tell? How did she get out?
2 o'clock
in the morning.
Yeah.
2 o'clock in the morning.
That's
even worse.
The phone rings at 1:45, 1:30 in the morning, and it's Mike Tyson calling Desiree from his limousine. And he pleads with her to come downstairs. He just wants to talk to her, she says. I really can't. It's so late. I'm already in bed. We don't have any makeup on. We've got rollers in our hair. I'm in my pajamas. And he says, well, you have to come down. Can't I see you tomorrow? Desiree asks him. Well, I'm leaving town very early in the morning. I just wanted
some parties together. Desiree is reporting all of this back to her roommates. And Desiree says, should I go? Should I go? Keisha and Pasha both say, sure, go for it. You know, it's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. You'll get to see some celebrities. You'll hang out with Mike Tyson. You know, go do it. Desiree gets downstairs. The limousine is waiting.
Well, you gonna sit with Mike in a limo? You know, honest Mike. She wanted to get an autograph picture for her father. 2 a.m. in the morning.
I don't know for sure if she went with, you know, Mike Tyson just to get the picture for her father, or just, you know, I think anyone would have gone with him, or like a celebrity, you know, just to say that she had been with a celebrity. And I mean, she obviously must have felt special that he picked her, you know.
I'm from New York. I'm from the inner city. I would not go to no man's hall 3 o'clock, especially if he's 25 years old. So, and I know she's even though she's one year older than me, she's 18. And she's considered an adult at that point, but still. Unless you're really naive or something's just wrong with you.
And then Tyson mumbles something, she says, about having to go back to the hotel. She thinks he says something about a bodyguard. So the limousine simply goes across the street to the Canterbury Hotel where Tyson is staying in Indianapolis.
It's like this. A yes is, if she come into your room after 3 o'clock, and it don't even matter what she got on.
She wants you.
And you conversating and you kissing, and after you get out of limo with her, she's following you there for, that's a yes. A no is, she's not going to go upstairs.
While Desiree is sitting at the edge of the bed, Tyson is at the head of the bed. And they've been talking about their various good deeds that they've done. Suddenly, Tyson leans forward, whispers into her ears, "You really turn me on," in a seductive voice that takes Desiree aback, she says. She jumps up because this really has startled her. She's expecting to go to parties, and suddenly this guy's putting the moves on her. She gets up and she says to him, a very stern voice, "Listen, I don't know what you've got in mind, but I don't want to do anything like that. You said we were going to parties to see celebrities. That's what I want to do."
I mean, how many times, sisters, have you said no and you mean yes all the time? Wait, talk now. Yeah. See, dealing with a man that don't know you. And the damn deceitful game that you play.
When I was growing up, a young woman could say no to a young man, and he could believe that she had been brought up not to before marriage, or not to until she was serious about someone, or that her father would be livid, or whatever it was. There was convention behind her no, and the weight of the community behind her no. That's all gone now, so that no, in effect, becomes, "I don't want to with you tonight." And a lot of men take that very badly. Tyson weighs over 200 pounds. Desiree is weighs somewhere between 95 and 110 pounds, just a frail little thing. And she is simply not up to fighting off the ex-heavyweight champion of the world. She says it all happens very quickly. He throws her down on the bed and is simultaneously stripping her clothes off, begins to fondle her, put his hands all kinds of places, is kissing her very violently, thrusting his tongue down her throat, and begins to attack her. He grabs her by the ankles, lifts her up. She's practically naked at this point, and starts to perform oral sex, and as I say, putting his fingers inside her. She is screaming at this point in pain because it's very painful, and Tyson continues, tells her, "Don't fight me." He's about to start intercourse and thrusts himself upon her, on top of her. She's still crying, still screaming, and he says, "Don't fight me, Mommy." That's what she testifies to.
On the news line, they did a flash about Mike being accused of raping a beauty contestant. And he never got angry at it. He was upset because he felt that The reason she was doing this was because he wouldn't walk her to the limousine that night. He said, I should have got off my ass and I should have walked downstairs to the limousine. Maybe she would have never done this.
The rule of groupies is very clear. You know, you get 15 to 20 minutes of not very good sex from an athlete, no kiss goodnight, no romance, and bragging rights among your friends. Hey, I slept with the leading scorer in the NHL, the leading scorer in the NBA, the great rock star or boxing champ. Everybody knows those rules. It's tragic. I wish they didn't exist. But Mike Tyson shouldn't be in jail or shouldn't be convicted of rape because of the groupie phenomenon in this country.
I just came here to pray that the jury, after all evidence is in, they would decide on the evidence of the case and not on race. Because both of them belong to us. And we must love both of them.
Tyson does not represent the best tradition of our community. In fact, Desiree Washington, a Sunday school teacher, a big sister, a volunteer for special athletic events for troubled children, that's more of a heroine or role model. Calling Mike Tyson a hero and asking for a lenient sentence after he's been convicted of rape. And how many black women have been raped in this society?
I think that the most painful thing for me about the trial is to really learn how expendable we are in our community. I watched the church, 50 Baptist ministers get together in Indianapolis and throw this vigil for Mike Tyson. Not one prayer was said for Desiree Washington. Not one. So this tells me that if I'm put up in my community against someone who is seen as a quote-unquote hero, who has more money than I do, has more status than I do, that has more power than I do, that I'm expendable.
She told me that she had went out on a date with Mike Tyson, and before she could say anything else, I was a Mike Tyson boxing fan. The man could do no wrong in the ring. Knockouts in one round, two rounds. He was great in the ring, and I idolized him. My father was a boxer when he was young. So we come from a family that follows boxing. And I says, oh, great, how'd it go? You know, did you get a picture? And she says, Dad, it wasn't all that great. I've got bad news for him. He's a rotten man. He's a dirty man. He's no good. And my heart fell down. I thought, well, gee, maybe he used profanity all night long. You know, maybe he didn't have any morals. Maybe he slapped her. That was the worst that I wanted to think. And then she hit me right between the eyes. Dad, he raped me. Tears welled up in my eyes. My heart sank. I went, I put my arms around her, and she used to really give me a real tight hug. And it was, I put my arms around her, but her hands were like this against my chest. And I felt it then. I knew that there was something just oddly wrong with her. And hopefully that this, I want my little girl back. I just lost her. And I'm not getting her back. I'm sorry. She will try to come back to me, but I don't think I'll ever have the little girl that I sent down to Indiana back.
Instead of preparing for another shot at the heavyweight crown, Mike Tyson was in Indianapolis today preparing to go to prison.
He spent 80 minutes with probation officials who interviewed him for a pre-sentencing report. When a fighter of Tyson's stature goes down for rape, the impact is felt by all of boxing. One of the first to feel the impact, heavyweight champ Evander Holyfield. He was guaranteed $30 million for his planned fight with Tyson. That fight, perhaps the biggest of all time, has now been scrapped.
We're out of here. See you guys.
Extremely to the extreme.